Okay, David's evil. Now we want to look at David's evil himself. And this is in chapter 11. And this is probably the most famous passage of David that everybody knows. Okay, this David's sin with Bathsheba. And let me start in chapter 11, verse 1. And it says this. In the spring, 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 1. In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war. Why is that a slam on David? First of all, why do the kings go out to battle in the spring? When do the crops come up of the wheat and barley? In the spring. So if you take your troops out in the spring, can you rip off all the farmers and get food for yourself, right? Who is the genius who did war all year round? Who was one of the first people that did that? He warred all year round, and actually it wasn't him, it was his father, who actually built this fighting machine where they could have supply lines so they could go all year round rather than just in the spring. Does anybody know Alexander the Great? Okay. Alexander the Great, okay. Alexander the Great, his father, Philip Macedon, he actually built the system and stuff. Alexander did it and stuff. But normally, kings went off to war in the spring because then you could just live off the crops that were coming up naturally. Is David going out to war over here in Jordan? It's saying in the spring when kings go off to war, is David going to go off to war with his men, or is David going to be sitting at home shacking up with this girl? Okay, so this is a slam on David right from the start here. The kings go off to war. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. Roof of the palace, high or low? Palaces are always what? High or low in the city? Palace is always high. David's king's palace is always high. David's on the roof of his house. He looks over to the other roof of his house, and there was a very beautiful woman. And David from the roof of his house, he saw a woman bathing. And I thought, oh, what do you mean? This woman's got like a bathtub up there. She's taking a bath, and David looks down, sees this woman like that. First of all, a lot of people try to accuse Bathsheba that she tries to seduce the king. Is that true? I want to say that's not true. First, let me just explain houses in Israel. The houses in Israel are shorter than from here to that pillar and over to the wall. That's the house. Question, when you're in the house, do you have privacy? There's no privacy in those homes. Do you understand? That basically things are open. When you want to get private, when you want to be by yourself, where do you go? You go up on the roof. The roof is where you have privacy. You don't have privacy down in your home. There's animals, there's people walking in and out and stuff. You got privacy, you go up on the roof. So she's one. Then question, she's bathing up there. Is this her bathing in a, you know, this big pool? First of all, would they have a bathtub? Would you waste water like that in Israel to take a bath in Israel with water? Would people waste water like that? No. She's probably taking a sponge bath, okay? That's the honest truth. Probably taking a sponge bath on her roof. David looks down and sees her, okay? This isn't, you know, her displaying herself and stuff. She's... Okay, so anyways, David looks down, so be careful about, just being careful here, the process of temptation then. So David looks, he sees that she's beautiful, he sees that she's bathing, and so he sees with his eyes. So the process of temptation, the eyes. Now question, do guys have problems with their eyes? Okay, do guys have problems with their eyes? The answer is yeah. But for me, it's always the second look that kills you, because why is the second look so important? The first look is just what? You may just see something you shouldn't really be seeing and stuff like that, but when you look back the second time, is there intention there? And so what I'm saying is watch out for the second look. Classic for me was, I remodeled a house once in a place called Winona Lake, Indiana. And our house was about 6 feet, maybe 10, 12 feet from the neighbor's house on this side, 10, 12 feet from the neighbor's house on that side. I gutted the house and rewired and replumbed it and did all that junk and stuff. So we were moving down, moving into the house. So I'm on my way up to school. I walk to school, and I'm a morning person, a serious morning person. I usually get up, I think this morning I was awake at about 10 to 5, and I usually get out. I just want to tell you, because my wife gets up a lot later and stuff, when you get up at, you know, 5, 5:30 and stuff, it's dark out then. And so I go out the door of my house, and it was early, I don't know, 6, 6:30 or something like that. And I walk out the door of my house, and I'm going to walk up to school. It's about 2 blocks up to the school. And as I walk out the door of my house, there is Kim, our neighbor, about 25-year-old woman who's married to her husband, Rich, and stuff. And there's a window there, and it had frosting on it. You know what I'm saying? Frosted windows that you can't see through. But what's the problem when you put a light behind the frosted window? all of a sudden, they know frosting there, if you know what I mean. So I'm standing there, and here's this woman standing there, bliko busha, as the Hebrews say, stark anyways, and she's taking a shower right there, and I'm saying, holy cow, you know? And I'm thinking, wow, man, 6 o'clock every morning, we get free shows. No, that was a joke. Okay, no. So, sorry. So I go up to school. Now question, do I have a problem? And you say, what do I do tomorrow? And you say, and question, I got a wife. Do I tell my wife? You say, what are you, out of your mind? You don't tell your wife that kind of stuff. Question, I got a wife. Question, does my wife know basically every thought that goes through my head? Do I tell my wife stuff like that? And you say, you don't do that. The answer is yes. We have a totally open, honest relationship. And I went home that day, and I knew I had to tell her. I said, you got to do something. Go over and talk to Kim. Just tell him to put up a curtain there, and we're cool and stuff like that. But I said, you got to go over and talk to her and tell her to cover that window. What did my wife say to me? She says, how can I go over there and tell him, hey, please put a curtain up there. My husband has a problem. Says, so how am I going to tell her to put a curtain up there that it's a problem? She says, I can't do that. And so she didn't do it. Now do I got a bigger problem? So question, the honest truth is, did I have to purposely, intentionally walk out the opposite door of my house on the opposite side and go up to school from that side every day for about a year and a half? And then when Joe and his wife moved in, the next couple moved in, what was the first thing was over there? And I do it myself. You got to get a curtain up in this window as soon as Joe moved in. And he, you know, then boom, he knew right away, and so it was no problem after that. What I'm saying is, you get in some situations, you have to be careful about your eyes. You have to be careful about your eyes. Question, we live in an internet age. Do you have to be careful about your eyes? As I look over in the seat over there, I see a student at Gordon College looking at pornography at Gordon College. You say, how did he get past that? Anyways, and sitting in a seat right over there. And what I'm saying is this a big problem in our culture? Big problem. So I'm saying guard your eyes, guys, especially guard your eyes, guard your heart and stuff. Second looks. Now, what happens? David sees her, but if he doesn't act, but does David take action now? He invites her up. Now, question, is this Bathsheba's problem? She invites him up. Some people say, oh, she's going up to seduce the king. Question, when he invites her up, where is her husband, by the way? Her husband, Uriah the Hittite, this guy isn't even Jewish, is out fighting David's war over in this area in Jordan. And David invites her up. When he invites her up, is she thinking she's going to get seduced, or is she probably thinking, what's David going to tell her? Her husband's out in battle, that David's going to tell her that her husband's been killed or hurt or something like that. So she goes up to see the king. The king seduces her. Now, by the way, is she partially culpable? I mean, it's mutual consent kind of thing at that point. But then what's the problem? And the problem is, I want to say, back off this blaming of Bathsheba. It's always the woman's fault. I don't think so. I think she consented to it eventually and stuff, but I think her coming up to David, she was probably thinking that he was going to tell her that her husband was dead, okay, and report that. Now, David and Bathsheba have relations. She finds out she's pregnant. How many, has her husband been out on the field for quite a while? She finds out she's pregnant. Does that take time? Okay, her husband's been on the field. So now David does what? He's got to cover his sins. So what does he do? He invites Uriah the Hittite back, and he says, send Uriah back here. So Uriah comes back, David comes in and says, hey, how's the war going? What's going on out there? You know, how's the war going? Stuff like that. What does David figure? The guy's been out on the field for at least a couple, 3-4 months. When he gets back home, what's the first person he's going to want to see? Is he going to want to see the king? Forget the king, man. He's going to want to see his wife, okay? Now what happens? Does he go down and see his wife? No. And I've heard some people say, well, that shows you that Uriah had a bad relationship with Bathsheba, and that's why Bathsheba cheated on him, because he had a bad relation. No. Does Uriah tell us exactly why he doesn't go down to his wife? Uriah explains to David why he didn't. He says, David, the Ark of God and Joab and all my buddies are out fighting a war. How can I go sleep with my wife when the Ark is out there? Do you hear the irony there? Do you hear the irony there? The Ark of God, David. He's a Jebusite. He's not even a Jew. And he's got more respect for the Ark of God and stuff. So then basically what happens is David says, okay, the guy won't go sleep with his wife. So, hey, when you want to get somebody to do something that they wouldn't do when they're thinking about it, what do you get to do? You get them drunk. So David says, let's get Uriah drunk. When he gets drunk, is he going to go home? When he gets drunk, he's going to go home. Even drunk, he won't go home. Has this guy got moral core principles, okay? So now what happens? David sends Uriah back out to the front lines, back over here to Joab, and he says, tells Joab, put him on the front line and then pull your troops back so Uriah will be killed. Now, by the way, is Joab worried about killing people? This is Joab, okay? So Joab puts him out there, pulls the troops back, sends the message back to David. Uriah is dead. Everything's taken care of, David. David gets away with it. Now, this is David's sin, not only the immorality with Bathsheba, but now the murder of Uriah the Hittite and stuff, who showed great uprightness. Uriah was a good person. He worked with the Jews. He was Uriah the Hittite. And, very interesting. Very interesting in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, whose name gets on there? She who was Uriah's wife. In the genealogy of David, it doesn't even mention Bathsheba's name. It mentions Uriah's name in the genealogy of Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 1. So I want to say Uriah is a good man. He was a good man. He was off at war. And by the way, when guys are off to war, do their wives cheat on them? When guys are off to war, do their wives cheat on them? My son was in Iraq. He said every one of the guys he was with that was married, every last one of them except one, their wives cheated on him when they were... Now, Talinda goes into battle. He goes into battle fighting for his life. He knows that his wife's at home cheating on him, sleeping with somebody else. Question, how do you fight a war when you know that kind of stuff's going on, you know? And the only one that was faithful in Afghanistan or in Iraq, when he went to Afghanistan, he came back, the only one that was left. Guess what? When he got back from Afghanistan, he got shot through the neck. He got shot through the neck, and it missed by less than a millimeter as the aorta coming down. He goes to his wife, and he says to his wife, basically, honey, you know, I love you. She gets him back, and she's like all over him, okay? He says, I got to have space. I'm not the same person. He's seen all sorts of stuff. There's a lot of stuff that happens in war. He says, I just need some space. I can't just be like I was. I've changed now, and I just need some space. I just need some space. And he kept saying, she couldn't give him space. And the next thing she did, ran up the credit card to $10,000, see you later, Charlie, and divorced him. Okay? That's really sad. And that was the only one left. Now, question, did my son have a good view of these things? No. It's all messed up. But anyway, but it's just what I'm saying is, in war, did these kind of things happen in the background? The answer is yes. Now, what happens? Nathan shows up. Nathan is the prophet. And Nathan is going to go to David. And Nathan is going to tell David a story about a guy with little lambs. Does David know about sheep and getting attached to little lambs? David knows all about that. And Nathan is going to say, there was a really wealthy guy. He had all these sheep, no problem. And this one guy had this one little lamb that used to rest in his arms and stuff. And when the rich man, somebody came to his house, the rich man said, oh, we need to have a little bit of lamb food here. So he went and took the lamb from the poor man and ripped it off and butchered it. And David was furious. That guy deserves to die. And Nathan looks at him and does what the prophets do the best. He says, David, you're the man. You're the man, David. You're the one. You had all these wives. You had all this stuff. But you took, this guy had his one wife. You took her. And then you killed him. And so Nathan, basically, is a prophet. What is the role of the prophet? Does the role of the prophet to rebuke the king? The prophet rebukes the king. Then what's the king do usually? Kills the prophet. Okay, the prophets usually lose. John the Baptist, you get your head cut off. Jeremiah, you get put in a septic tank for 3 days. Okay, so anyways. But what with David? Does David kill Nathan? No, David repents. And I want to look at David's repentance next time. We'll actually go through the process of repentance and stuff. So, okay, see you on Tuesday.